either.
It's a very frustrating game, I don't know why adults even do it, really.
I thought it was supposed to be relaxing, and every time Brad comes home, he's like.
But because people take it too seriously, you know, it's supposed to be right fun.
It's like a police department.
And if people don't have fun, they should quit it. I mean, people that complain about it and throw their clubs and, I mean, we're out there playing and people are bitching about this and that, I'd say, you know what, we're on a golf course here, you know. This, we're not curing world hunger or.
We're supposed to be having fun, folks.
This isn't serious, this is golf, okay, and so you hit your ball in the river, you know, get over it, it's just golf, yeah.
I'm sure it says golf for people who don't get enough frustration at work.
Working.
Hi, Lisa.
Hi.
Are you feeling better?
I am, thank you.
Yeah, good.
Yeah. Still a little bit tender.
Yeah.
Gallbladder out 2 weeks ago.
Oh my goodness. Like emergency, right?
I did, yeah.
And you have the, you didn't have the robot one, right?
Yeah, the laparoscopic. It is cool, but it's still.
So long recovery.
Wasn't it after this last meeting in here you left and went to the hospital? Is that what I saw?
I think it was. It was like, because it was the.
Well, it was like that night or the night after I saw that you were like, okay, I'm here.
Yeah, it was, well, it was the Friday before the 4th of July. Mm. My days seem to be running together.
Yeah, that's pretty close then.
Yeah, woke up one
good
in the morning.
Good for you, you're up and around.
Yeah. Well, you know, family doesn't like to take too much time off.
Yeah.
I say you should milk it.
Oh, I am. I'm not vacuuming for the rest of the summer.
There you go. Well, I'm sorry to hear that, but glad you're feeling a little better.
Thank you. I appreciate it. So are we waiting to see if the power comes back on? Or?
We're waiting for John Paul.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
They're waiting to be done eating.
The power will come on 5 minutes after we get in our car.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about him. I know. We want to leave.
You remember about, I guess it would have been about 14 years ago, we had that horrible winter ice storm that lasted like over a week. Like everything was just down for about a week. We planned a surprise 60th for my mom at Gino's. And of course I get a call at like whatever time saying that the power was out and they were gonna do the best they could to make it happen. And they called back later and they had gotten the power on. We got my uncle was coming in from Texas and we got in, had the party, and on the way out, literally as we're shutting the door, the power went out again and it was out for the rest of the week.
That was like divine intervention.
Yeah, I thought, I don't know what I'm going to do with all these people that are coming, and the roads were horrible, and it stayed on for, you know, 3-4 hours, and then boom, that was all.
Know how Bill Holbrook is doing? Oh,
no,
his wife.
She was doing well enough to be in a walker.
No walker.
Yeah. So that's pretty good though, because she wasn't supposed to put any weight on for, I think it was 6 weeks. So if she can be in a walker, then she's improving pretty well.
Pretty well.
I think it's been 3 now.
Okay.
So, yeah.
What happened to Bill Holbrook's wife?
She fell and broke whatever this top leg bone is, right at the very top. So she didn't break her hip, but she broke her leg bone, like almost inside her hip.
Hey, John Paul.
Yeah, and then,
so
they have some surgery and get screws put in.
The light's still on.
Yeah, there's no power, is that what's going on?
Yeah.
We're trying for ambulance. More cold.
We're trying to save money if we can't pay the electric bill.
Yeah.
Well, it's in the truck with flashing lights, it's down this way. Further down that way.
Hey, Rob, can you get me a York peppermint patty while you're in there? Thank you.
Nothing here, just peppermint.
Don't get up, Bob, they realize.
Can you get by?
Yep, I can get by, sure, no problem.
Perfect.
I was gonna take that for you, John.
Oh, thank you.
Anybody else got anything they want?
Actually, it's just right here.
Just so you know, this will be my last meeting because I got a call from the IRS today.
That you're going to jail.
I'm going to jail.
Yep.
I got the same call. Buzz is after me. The local cops are gonna come and arrest me, so just so you know, I'll probably be going away for a while. Funny, all my friends are going away too, like, they're all been invited to go to jail.
My poor 21-year-old daughter did not know, I didn't think, you know, when you're teaching her how to do her laundry and all those things, anyways, she got a call at school and.
You don't think to say, oh, it's over for that.
So she shared her social security number, she thought it was real. So then we put a freeze on all her accounts and, you know.
Oh my gosh, really?
She was so upset, but she's like wanted to take care of everything on her own and she called me after the fact.
Hi, how are you?
You Mark?
I am.
Marlene?
Got your text after I got my waiver yesterday.
That's certainly not where I need to take you out.
I got your text after I got off my waiver.
Exactly, just so you know, the IRS will never, the IRS won't call you, that's.
We were having a little fun.
I went on my waiver when we received the phone call, you know, the cell phone calls.
Yeah. I haven't got too many.
My phone's been ringing off the hook.
Really?
Oh my gosh.
I haven't got too many of those. Not yet, it'll start.
Apparently our district is very contested.
You guys get the ones from the IRS telling you that you're under investigation?
Yeah, that's what she's.
Just talking about that, she said this would be her last board meeting, she's gonna have to go to jail.
Well, me too.
I'm serious fraud or something.
Okay.
Okay, Marlene, for sake of light, it's all yours.
All right, so. First of all, let me say that, I had a conversation with John Paul, I think on Sunday or something.
Friday.
And Friday, and he said, you know, I want to warn you that you're coming into something and people think that you're here at the behest of John and Keith and you're working for them and so on. So let me just be clear about a couple of things, right? I did the search for your superintendent, as you remember. And I met a board at that time that was a 4-3 board. You weren't getting along very well and you weren't sure you could pick the next superintendent. And I think you surprised yourself that you did, and you did it in fine fashion. I shook Keith's hand that night and said, congratulations and good luck. And that's the last time I spoke to Keith since the other day. And I came to meet with John and Keith. And I did the same thing with John. That was the first time I'd seen John. So I have not kept close touch with Waterford. I don't really know a whole lot about what's going on, but I wanted to share with you how I happened to be here. John called MASB and asked for a board workshop on governance. Donna Oser, who's in charge of leadership, was in the office at the time, and she said, why don't you call Marlene? You know, she did their search. Maybe she did their workshop. So they called me and said, Marlene, will you do the workshop? I don't usually do the governance workshop. That's not, I have done them, but there are other people in this group that do the governance workshop. But I have done them. And I said, okay, you know, I've worked with Waterford, I'll do that. So it's typical when you do a governance workshop that you meet with the board chair and the superintendent to plan it and talk about what's gonna happen. Subsequent to that first conversation, I decided to check in and see what was happening in here. And so I watched a number of your board meetings and I could see that things were not going smoothly. So when I came to meet with John and Keith, I said, you know what, there is a governance workshop, it's a PowerPoint, all the roles and responsibilities of board members and superintendent and so on. I said, but I don't really think that that's what you guys should be working on, because I don't think that's really what the problem is. I think most of you know what your roles and responsibilities are, you're just having a difficult time trying to figure out how to discharge them. So I sensed a lot going on, and in all fairness, I will tell you that Mark called me over the weekend, or Friday, or someday, and he told me, where's the agenda, and so on, he wanted to know what was going on, and I said, there isn't an agenda, you're the agenda, the board's the agenda. There's no workshop that's gonna happen tonight, it's gonna be you guys talking, or not. And I'm saying all this because when I came up here and gave the presentation to do the search, if you remember, I told you then that I did this work because I care about leadership and I care about boards and I care about people working together effectively. I don't do it for the money that I get to do this little workshop. I don't do the searches for that reason either. And so I don't have a personal vested interest in this myself, okay? If you all said to me, you know, Marlene, we don't think you're the right person, we want somebody else from MESB, not you, because you have relationships or associations, that's fine by me. I think you all know I'm never looking for work. I think I could be helpful, but it's kind of up to you. What I thought is I was, thinking about coming up here was my concern for you is that you're not operating effectively together. And that always hurts me personally in leadership because I think you all ran for the board for reasons of goodwill and you're here because you care about the kids in Longford. And I think adult issues are kind of getting in your way and I don't know what they all are and I'm not even sure if you know what they all are. So I wanted to start by saying to you, if I can facilitate in any way to help you get to a better place, then that's what I want to do. If you don't think I can or I should because I'm not the right person, that's okay too. It's kind of up to you. But I wanted to kind of disclose that and let you know where I was coming from. I think I could perhaps help you facilitate a conversation that might get you started. But my sense is that some of the issues are kind of deep and the wounds are out there. And it might be more difficult for you to get to a good place and there might be some other kind of work that I might be able to do. But anyway, that's the starter. So tell me what you think. Just gonna kick it back to you guys.
Just so we're open, though, I think you had one conversation with Joan as well, I believe.
I called Joan early on and said, is it Rob and you? That's pretty much what I wanted to know.
It was Rob and I last time.
It was Rob and you the last time, and I just wanted to know when we were revisiting the same thing.
She has more time on the board, she understands.
And she said, no, it's not Rob.
I know the error in my ways.
Said there are other issues with other board members.
So, yeah. We're getting along.
So, and honestly, guys, it doesn't matter to me who the issues are with. And I don't have a side in it. It doesn't matter to me what your issues are and who likes who and who doesn't and who feels this or that. It's immaterial to me. You know, I'll also say that when Mark called me on the phone and he asked my opinion about things, I said my opinion. It's just my opinion. I looked at your board meeting and I'll tell you, I felt bad for you. I felt bad that that's where you are as a board. And I made my opinion, but that doesn't mean that I can't come here and listen to you. You all have a point of view. You got stuff going on. And I'm a good listener and I'm a good facilitator. And if I can help you, I will. And if you don't think I can, then I have something to say.
Well, I think personally, I'll go first, I guess. I think from my experience having worked with you in our superintendent search, I find you to be very objective, very open, honest, frank, and I appreciate your leadership style, and I think regardless of whether you've worked with us before or not, or at least some of us, I think that you can actually be very helpful and very beneficial to us as we try to move forward.
Thank you. I should say, I don't want to be the issue here. You have enough issues.
But I think it's kind of to the heart of when we start, though, because like I said when I spoke to you, that when I had heard it was you, yeah, I heard the name and I didn't register it with me. And then when I realized that it was you, I looked at your number, I looked at my email from the superintendent search and had your number in there, so that's why I reached out to you and called you, just to get a little information on what the process looked like to you and what it would be. You know, to be honest with you, that I don't know necessarily so much that it was you, but it was to the extent that I think there was some mistrust that Keith and our board president were the two that, you know, decided who was going to come and bring you in. And then I know, you know, I do agree with the objectivity piece from my experiences with you. But, you know, it does, with all the mistrust that we've had with this board, I think it does register some alarm bells with people when they hear the person who did the superintendent search, who's already been involved with this board previously, is now getting back involved. And we kind of just bring that all back to, you know, the selection of you know, Dr. Wunderlich. So I think that's why some of those bells went off with people.
Well, what about you, John? Did it go
off
with you, and where
it did. I'll be honest with you. I did for a minute, just because of some of the relationship issues that I've had with Mr. Wunderlich and Mr. Himmelspa, for sure. That's why I wanted to give you the benefit of the doubt and call you. And that's why I looked your number up and gave you a call and had a conversation with you.
Right. Do you understand then from what I said that that's what the protocol would be? Whoever they call from NESB, if Debbie Steer came and did it, she would have met with John and Keith. That's what you do. You meet with the board chair to talk about. I mean, I've done a couple of these and that's what I do. So it wouldn't have been any different had it been a different NESB person. They still would have come and met. But, so.
Just to clarify, when I called NESB,
you didn't answer.
No, you're the only name they gave me. And that's why I threw it out at the last board meeting, so everybody knew the name that was given to me. And not hearing any objections, I figured let's go along. But I had no impact, no suggestion, positive or negative, on MASB on who they should send. So
I think it's just good that we clarified it, you know,
sure.
That it was good in the front, so that
I want to clarify.
It was clarified.
Do you feel comfortable now, John Paul?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't necessarily feel uncomfortable with it. It's just I wanted to know more and about what we were going to do. And I mean, the experience I had with Marlene last time, I said to her, you're a pretty straight shooter, you know, pretty forthright with information. I'm comfortable with it the way I look at it, but I guess I kind of want to see how this goes too. So, you know, like I said, it's just PTSD from this board or something, you know, just a little bit.
Well, you all are.
You know,
basically the same conversation I had with Marlene was like, don't bring me this burdenous standard presentation because I don't think that's what we need. I think you need to come here and feel us out and take it from there. So I'm wide open. I don't know where this is going. I don't know if it lasts 5 minutes or 5 hours.
Well,
so.
That's the truth, you guys. It'll last as long as you want it to last. You know, it's as I said, I don't have an agenda here other than trying to see if I can help you get to a better place as a board. If that's possible, if it's not, yeah, it's okay. I definitely want to drive out here anyway and have the conversation.
Well, I appreciate that all 7 board members made time in their schedule in a very busy summer, on a hot summer evening with no power. And I think that speaks to the commitment that we all have to try to move our board forward. So I really applaud the board for all being ready to be engaged and appreciate you being here to help facilitate that.
Rob?
Here. No, I didn't hear John say what you were going to be doing it. Because again, you and I had some differences during the search. I love your straightforwardness, and I have a straightforwardness, so I didn't know what was going along. I didn't feel you were, you were not pushing Keith whatsoever as our superintendent. He was kind of on the back burner. I think we more or less pulled him out of the names. So there was no stirring whatsoever by you with Keith. Again, there was one name on the list that I did have a concern with, but you're not it. Again, you've always been a straight shooter. And I like that. That's why I kind of wanted you to be the superintendent, but you want to go golfing. So
start the discussion group.
Can you say you and Wayne, what's your thoughts?
Well, I mean, I know a few of the other MASP folks, and I've worked with a couple of them before. I worked with you through the superintendent search, and when you called me, I said no. And then you said, well, let's just have a cup of coffee and talk about it. And so I ended up, you know, throwing my hat into the ring, and here I am. So I think if there is somebody who could turn a no to a yes, you might be the right person.
You said no?
I did say no.
He did.
No,
yeah.
He didn't.
And by the way, I'm guessing he's cursing Marlene right about now.
I did say no.
You don't always need to know how the sausage gets made. My job is to, as a search consultant, and I'm doing the Flint search right now, and that's a real that's a real challenge. But you know, I told you guys, my job is, as a search consultant, is to try and bring as many qualified candidates as I can, and you're going to choose somebody. And you, I try very hard not to get involved in who gets chosen, because I might have an opinion, but that does, that's neither here nor there. The seven of you came to consensus around Keith, as I recall, and were shocked that you did. And were absolutely shocked among yourselves that you could do that. So, what? And I've used your board as an example. I haven't called out your name, I have used the Waterford board, not by name, but I've used your board as an example of, as I've run into some other boards that were. Had issues with each other about the superintendent and so on. And I've been clear with boards that, you know, you can, this process can be a good process to help you resolve some of your, find your commonalities. And so I think, and I think all the way through the process I applauded you, and I still do, for your commitment to, you know, to work together to come up with a solution. And so, see, so I know that you got it in you. I know that that is possible for you to be a board that is, and when I say more effective, what I really mean is less frustrated. You know, I sense so much frustration in the few old clips of board meetings that I watch. And I really hate to see that. I hate to see people being frustrated and not communicating well with each other. And it's just, it just doesn't bode well for you personally. You all ran to the board not to be frustrated. You ran to the board to do something good. And that's why people run for boards. They want to do something good. And so when you find yourself in a situation where you're being frustrated, that's not a good situation for anybody. So
I'd like to just state for the record, for the camera over there, I find it, despite freedom of speech and what have you, I find it incredibly inappropriate and disrespectful to be filming this particular meeting. I know it's a public meeting, but these are very personal conversations that we're trying to have as a board to develop our team, and I don't think that it's necessarily needs to be aired on Facebook for all the world to see. I mean, there's some very honest, open conversations that we're going to have, and I don't think the community deserves to be privy to those conversations. So I just wanted to state that for the record.
So, Mary, where are you on this? You weren't in the search. I mean, you were an observer of it. I mean,
I was.
I know you
I
came
in
to all
the
meetings.
Right, and I filled out a very glowing recommendation to hire Keith. I mean, I had worked with Keith before. Of all the candidates, he was the one I thought that that did a great job. So coming here and being on the board and having the issues that have happened really did surprise me, especially, you know, with Keith. I worked with him before. We were co-principals. I wrote to the board that I thought, you know, we start turning those surveys after
right.
everything, and I was, you know, all over him, you know, saying he's the one I think you should hire as an observer. So, what I believe through my lens is that it's processes that bother me that aren't getting followed.
We're gonna get to that in just a second, but are you okay with us having
right, right? So, you know, I don't have a problem with people, but if people don't follow processes, then that bothers me. And so just even hearing about this, I will say I wondered, I had thought a board governance person would be like a former board member, like an ex-board president or someone who had done that. So, you know, it did run through my mind having an ex-superintendent. Your perception is going to be perhaps different as how, you know, where you might have a different take on things than a board president. My personal story of leaving Waterford, having been here for 23 years, and then going to Howell for two, they ran completely different. And I believe they ran a lot more transparent, much more transparent, more everything was out in the open. This type of discussion would absolutely have been on camera because whatever happens tonight will affect how we govern in the future. So that is a public interest. So anyway, my take on this stuff is.
So you were concerned.
I was, well,
that
you know,
I,
but
that
I can't.
I have
you know,
an appropriate perspective.
No, and then I heard from John Paul, like, who are you? I didn't know who you were. I just heard you were an ex-superintendent. And then I heard you met with John and Keith. And I honestly, I'm sure my name is brought up with John and Keith and Joan's conversation. So I wondered why I didn't get a call, you know, and I guess this is fine, we could do it now, but,
okay.
So
let me just clarify that there are a number of people at NESB who do the governance workshop. Some are school board members, previous school board members, some are superintendents. And as I said, we're not really doing the governance workshop. And we're going to see if we can get to what some of the other issues are, and then you might need to do the governance workshop. But the governance workshop right now, I don't think would be that helpful to you because there's underlying stuff that you haven't resolved. So, and the reason when John called, I just want to be clear, when John called, the gal who's in charge of governance workshops is named Debbie Stater, and she was on a two-week vacation. And that's why they called me and said, Marlene, you worked with Waterford before, would you be willing to do this? That's the other reason. Or you might add Debbie.
Yeah, because Debbie was an ex-board member, right?
Yeah,
was
a board member in Utica or something.
Yeah.
Anyway, she's a long time worker. Bob, where are you at?
Query.
Yeah, you're a smart pants.
Right. We'll see how it works. I think when John first approached me about doing this, I was okay with it. I think in reality, you should have a board governance workshop once a year. You know, I don't think there's any bad to it. I think it's, you know, good. I wasn't sure when I heard your name, I wasn't sure if that would be good because you did kind of know this board and this district, or would that not be so good because you did have some familiar ties with us. And again, I didn't know, but I'm certainly open to see where we go, see how it works out, and see what happens. I mean, if you know, we need to do something. So,
okay. All right. So then we're going to keep going. So
I don't think we can go 5 hours. But
we're not going to be 5 hours. It's too hot. We're going to lose. We're going to be in the dark.
Mm-hmm.
So I want you to think about. Ask you a question. I want you to suggest something in the past. I want you to think about one word, that would describe how your board interactions are now. How your board is when you think about the board. What's a word that would describe how you are?
How about trust?
Lack of it?
Mm-hmm.
Trust issues. So yeah, miserable, contentious, trust.
I have the word, I was looking for a better word, but the word block. I just feel like any time.
Okay.
I ask for something, it's black, because everything is just black, 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 black.
Yeah, for you blacks.
Antagonistic.
Antagonistic, right.
I hit train wreck, but I crossed it off and put trust.
Well, either one's kind of right.
I'm a train wreck then, not this trust.
All right, that's fine.
Single.
Single.
We're not a board, we're single, individually.
Individuals.
Right, no matter what goes on, we still stay single, and no matter, we don't operate as a board.
So, all right.
Dysfunctional.
Okay, so, so we have miserable, dysfunctional, antagonistic, lack of trust, blocking, not a pretty picture, in other words, for those of you that come to board meeting. How many board meetings you have a month?
Two.
So, twice a month for sure, you're gonna have all these feelings, all right? So, could you, I just want you to also take a minute and think about the word that you used, whatever it was. And I want you to think about some behaviors that go with that word. So what does it look like when it's miserable? What does it look like when it's contentious? What does it look like when it's dysfunctional, when it's single, when it's a train wreck? So tell me some of the behaviors that you see at a board meeting. Your word comes into your head. So take a minute. Got it. Describe it, see what it looks like.
I don't know what's going on. Show up to a meeting, or you get the agenda for the meeting, and you're just blindsided by stuff. So I'd say probably things that are associated with that was you don't know what's going on, lack of preparedness because you can't prepare adequately, and a lack of communication.
So your dysfunction then looks like lack of communication, unpreparedness, not your ability to do your work effectively. I'm just
right.
Paraphrasing.
Yeah, no,
if I get the paraphrase wrong, don't get the other wrong. Okay.
Exactly, my ability to do my job correctly.
Okay. Somebody else?
I kind of don't want that sentence because it's kind of a surprises and gotchas, but I do have an agenda, but it's trying to be added to. Some people have, they know what they want to talk about, but the rest of us don't. So by not having it on the agenda, it is a surprise. By adding it the night of a meeting is a surprise or a gotcha when some people have discussed it amongst themselves, some haven't. So if I get to a meeting and something wants to be added, that's a surprise.
So similar to what John Paul's saying, that's from a slightly different perspective,
well,
but it's
because
still a lack of communication.
My agenda is clear and precise.
Understood. Okay. All right. Others?
For me, the contentiousness is I feel that people interrupt each other a lot when we're trying to have a organized meeting. I think people work kind of hard to embarrass each other. Disrespect each other. There's a lot of body language, the rolling of eyes, a lot of sarcasm, lack of respectful conversation as we're in public view, and a lot of demands that are made of people as individuals and as a group. or a previously discussed request for something, there was a lot of, I would say like independent demands.
Okay.
For.
So that's what contentious, that's not, those are the behaviors that you see.
That's what I see.
Okay. So we've seen what Heather thinks contentious looks like, what John Paul thinks dysfunctional looks like, what Rob thinks a train wreck looks like. John, what does single look like?
Well, it takes us 30 minutes to even start a meeting. You know, because we can't, we right. There's either not, the agenda was not prepared, or just too many things being thrown at the agenda. We, it takes us. There's a lot of demand speeches and defense speeches built into our meetings. That, you know.
Okay. So.
And then you know, at some point, we all have opinions, and we have honest opinions, and we give our opinions, but we're still a board. Mm-hmm. If I get voted against every time, I'm still part of this board. I need to support whatever that majority was and move on. That's where I keep coming back to single. So if I keep bringing my issue up and the board keeps saying something different, that's not being as a board. Mm-hmm. As strongly as I feel about my position. So
Mary, how about block? What's it look like?
No, you can't. We've always done it this way. You don't know. No discussion, like no true discussion. Getting told no isn't a discussion, right? Or just flat out topic ignored, request for something, or just a non-answer. And then I think the blocking too, I think there's been, I don't know, an attempt or whatever, but behavior behind the scenes where emails get sent that are attacking and personal and I think that's an attempt to block, to behind the scenes say these types of things, so then when the next meeting, hopefully, you know, behavior will be different. But I
so the blocking and the no and we don't do it this way and all of those mm-hmm. behaviors that you see
without discussion
are
just
part of
the answer is just no.
So they're so that leads also probably to some of the contentious messages.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All right, Bob.
You know, with trust, it's just, I think it's just like in the air with this board right now. I think it's so divided. There's such a wedge that's been driven down in that I think so far what everybody has said, we all agree with, or at least I'll say I agree with everything that everybody has said. And I think that just all, you combine all of that together and that gives you the lack of trust. So I don't know specific, but it's just in the air.
So it's overarching for you. It just
mm-hmm.
covers everything.
Right.
Keith?
I had one of Mary's descriptive words. I had personalized as well and accusatory. Mm-hmm. That's all. It's about specific people's, you know, what they did or what they said or.
So it's a personal thing.
Right.
So like what Heather was saying, personal.
Very personal.
Disrespects.
Mm-hmm.
John, miserable.
I picked that word because I had several other words in my head and I couldn't tie them all together with anything specific enough besides miserable. So I think many of the things I put grandstanding, personal agendas, lots of gotcha moments, adversarial, personal attacks, Facebook recaps that don't clearly define what the facts were and they're attacking, disrespectful to the members of the board, all members of the board, to the administration, to the staff, and to the community that we serve. And it's the community no longer has confidence if they're paying at all attention in our ability to lead as a result, which is really demoralizing and frustrating.
I'm miserable.
I'm miserable.
Okay. How do you feel when it's, what, I forget, what night is your board meeting?
Thursday.
Okay, so you're getting ready to go to the board meeting on Thursday. Mary, how are you feeling when you get in your car?
No, I hate it.
Bob, how are you feeling?
I think, I think Heather, I remember her saying 6 months ago or whatever, in a meeting, that she had never been so embarrassed to be a part of the board. And I'm that same way. I literally do not enjoy being with this group of people anymore. You know, I still love the district. I mean, I praise it constantly about what it did for my daughter and my family. But this board and just, and it's, again, this board is not only divided, but the community is divided. I mean, it's reached out beyond the board into the community. I mean, it's unreal the amount of chatter you hear now against this person, against that person, whatever. It's you know, I mean, talk of recalls and just, it's a shame.
It's not fun.
Oh, it's not fun one bit.
That comes from not just around this table.
So, Heather, your social media part, how are you feeling when you get hit from the board meeting?
I feel hopeful that maybe this time will be different. And then usually pretty discouraged and pretty disappointed at the end because nothing changed.
Rob, how do you feel getting your car to come to board meeting?
Excited. See what kind of stupid's going to happen tonight.
Are you being facetious or is that the truth?
A little bit. Or both. Again, it's an embarrassment. But again, it's, can we top the stupid that happened last time? Mm-hmm. I guess we can. So,
John, how do you feel getting in the car?
You know, I have no problem coming to board meetings. I come early, but I tell you at the end, I've been more frustrated leaving than anything on my whole board. Almost in my life, but coming, I still no problem coming. It's leaving. That's the frustration.
Okay. Well, you stay overnight then.
Yeah,
John Paul, how do you feel getting in the car?
I feel fine, actually. I think, kind of same thing with John. I it doesn't bother me coming because I know, I think maybe I've gotten just used to, you know, what's going on, but not in a bad way, but in a way that, you know, I know that if I don't speak up and say what I think it is truthful and honest, that I'm going to walk out of there regretting that I didn't do something, and you know, cite whatever the issue was that I wanted to bring to the forefront. So, I mean, the meetings don't bother me at all.
So, Keith, you didn't volunteer for this job. I mean, like they all did. They're all volunteers.
You said no.
So, how do you feel when it's Thursday in here?
I'm always really confused because we've got a district that's made some incredible gains in the last 4 or 5 years. Has, you know, financially has gone from a $1 million fund balance to 6.8. Now, you know, we were on the watch list for the state treasury for districts, so we had fiscal risk, and we're, you know, well beyond that now and off that list. We had priority schools, now we've got reward schools. We're knocking the socks off of NWEA growth. We're finally beating the state on the MSTEP. You know, everything that you want to see in a school district is, Waterford's a great example of that. And yet I go to a board meeting and get attacked when the district is doing great things, and so I'm confused.
Can you chime in on that real quick?
Hold on, John, did you go?
No. I vacillate between being cautiously optimistic and incredibly frustrated. I always kind of think, you know, how we each and every one of us choose to spend our time, what we choose to work on, what we choose not to, and is just as important as what we choose not to work on. And I continually try to assess, is what we're doing affecting change? What can we do better? How can we possibly move forward as a district? And then when I leave the meeting, I think I share John's thoughts, and I've never been so discouraged, or really, it's devastating. It's devastating, it's embarrassing, and it's really hard to be part of.
Can I expand? Because everyone gave a whole bunch of words, and I just said,
that's fine, Mary. Go ahead.
I had that feeling because of
what feeling?
I said, you asked me how I like what I felt like with board meetings. I said, I hate them. Like, okay. I hated going there.
All right.
And it's not because of, you know, being part of the district or if, you know, seeing the growth, whatever, all that's fine. But it's, I mean, the looks, I think John is the only person that reached out to me to have a conversation with me about in the very beginning, and that was a long time ago, when we had lunch together.
John
has fun. But other people here, I've just gotten terrible emails from them. They sigh in the meetings, they, you know, roll their eyes, I can hear them, feel them, when I'm just asking, I believe, just asking questions, or trying to, you know, have something get put on the agenda, whatever it is. And that's what I hate. It's that disrespect, that treatment. Again, like I said, I was worked in another district. I saw this stuff happened all the time. It was part of what should happen, so no one was upset about it. But it's just that everything's an upset. Any question's an upset, any wonder's an upset, and it just, it's tiring, but I'm not gonna not do it because I believe that is my role. And John and I talked at lunch that I think there's a fundamental difference about what our roles are, that we can still talk about tonight, that that I think is at the heart of it. So.
Okay. So what started, it sounds like what started as questioning and not understanding how things are done here versus how they're done other places, the transparency issue and so on, that's what I'm kind of getting from, mm-hmm. has now snowballed into a lot of personal feelings, and it's gotten beyond just the asking questions and so on. So let me ask you, do you want it to be different?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. I think we would be here.
I agree. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We're all here.
You're here because you want it to be different. And as you know, just think about your families. Think about not just your nucleus family, but your extended family. Think about all the problems you've ever had in your family. Think about what happens when trust breaks down. Think about your kids, when you're trying to get two kids to come to a peaceful place with each other, and they've hurt each other over the years and so on. You know how difficult it is when people's feelings have been hurt. And you can say, oh no, my feelings don't get hurt, but you do. Your feelings get hurt because you don't feel valued, you feel disrespected, you feel that you're not acknowledged as a person that you think you are. That's kind of what's happened here. And what I saw in my two or three little vignettes of watching the board, that's what I saw. And what I saw before, this is the difference between how you were when I first met you and you were in disagreement, 4 and 3 and so on. You still got work done. You still pretty much ran the Waterford School District. Even though you couldn't agree on whether the superintendent was any good, you were 4 and 3 about that, you still were able to come together and do the work in the district, vote on things, and more times than not, you voted 7-0 or 6-1 or something. So you were able to be functional, even though you had some disagreements and some personal pieces with each other. So that's the difference now. You're not able to be as functional. So you all want it to be different, okay? So if you could imagine, all right, so I want you to think about it's different, okay? You've been in these kind of little visioning exercises. I want you to vision for me the board meeting that you would like to participate in. What would it look like? Okay, you're coming to the meeting, you're arriving at the place where you have your meeting. What would it look like if it was the kind of meeting that you felt proud of and wanted to be part of? Spend a minute, think about it. What would it
look?
board meeting that you want to be a part of? Bob, what would it look like?
What would it look like? It would be a board meeting where we didn't necessarily agree on everything. I think in years past, at least, I heard a lot about, you know, 5-6 years ago that we were basically a rubber stamp board. So certainly with lots of discussion, maybe some disagreement, but disagreement in a professional way, without, like Heather said, the eye rolling, without the sighs, without the interruptions. You know, things don't have to be a 7-0 vote, they could be a 6-1 or a 5-2. But we do it just in a cordial way, in a professional way. And that when that meeting got over with, we accepted the decisions that were made and the votes that were taken, and you know, we move on and we talk about how's everyone's families doing, spouses, kids, and again, we get along and we do what's right for the district. Not always agreeing, you know, being able to have differences, but doing it in a respectful way, a polite way, not with all that other stuff, and then moving forward. That would be a perfect board meeting.
So that perfect board meeting that you're envisioning, have you had that before? Can you remember a time when that's what it looked like here for you as a board member?
Yep.
Mary, what about you? What would it look like for you if you felt like it was a board meeting that you were proud to be part of?
Full discussions on topics, like full discussions where questioning, where the discussion would have questions in it that rise to oversight, where the questions are actually not hard questions, but they're questions that like have to do with it. That right now, if I ask a question to Bill Holbrook, I'm insulting him, I'm making the district look bad, it's awful, I'm attacking him, I'm putting him off, and it's like a budget was put in front of me, I'm asking questions about whatever that is, and then that scene is, you know, surprising him and tricking him. That shouldn't be. If we're talking and having a discussion about a topic, and I think it's something I should be able to talk about it and ask about it. But that would be perfect. And again, I've seen it at Howell, and I've seen it, you know, probably long ago here. I think decisions should be reached from that discussion, like that night, instead of having to decide it all in the back room and then come out and just like, barely talk about it and vote. I don't, that might be a fundamental disagreement, but I don't think that's how we should operate as a board. It should be full and transparent. So transparency about everything we do, all the questions that I ask be answered. That hasn't happened. I get told no, get told we're not gonna tell you, or don't ask, stop asking. And then all of our policies followed. That has to happen. I really am. I think one of the most frustrating things, I think probably the three against the four is the policy. Policy's not being followed. We've never had a discussion about it. Never had it on the agenda. I've asked it to be, I've motioned for it to be, and it has not been. And then comments are, we've already covered that. I'm like, no, we haven't. So that's the frustration. So is it anyone in particular? No, it's that we won't have that discussion and that we won't do it. So it becomes people because they're the ones that are not doing it.
Okay. Keith, what would it look like for you?
I use the word respectful, but I described that as no accusations, no gotchas, no surprises.
Mm-hmm. All right,
Rob, what about you? I'm trying to think of the Louis Armstrong song that he sings. We're big and deep from Good Morning Vietnam. That's
what a wonderful world.
What a wonderful world. I want that playing in the background because we have our meeting. Basically, is we have an agenda. You follow it. Again, we get the agenda the week before approximately, and if there's questions, you call the people that are involved. If we're buying something, call to find out what that is, the details. you can still ask the details during the meeting, but I need to be able to make decisions, not on the spot, because if I don't have all the information. People being prepared. You get an agenda, any questions you have, you ask of the people in charge. You trust their answers. You don't keep asking in a different way, and you accept the answers. And you move along, and it's nice and peaceful and quiet, and everyone gets along.
Peaceful and quiet, and everybody gets along. Nobody sighs or rolls their eyes.
A beautiful world is playing in the background.
And a beautiful world is playing.
It just makes me feel better.
Hey, I'm just going to get the track. I'm going to bring it up here, and I'm going to be cool.
That's for me. That's for me. So I mean, I don't know what everyone else, but I enjoy that. So.
You don't want to be singular.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, first of all, we have to somehow, at some point, come to some agreement. How are we going to send an agenda? Because it's like, this should be on there, this shouldn't have been on there, this was too fast, this was too slow, and we spent a lot of time just into. And then grandstanding, I mean, I think we need to respect staff, so it's fine to ask all your 100 questions, but it's better to give that employee the questions the day before and say these questions are coming so that they can at least be prepared. I think we need to respect staff more. I think they get defensive because they feel they're attacked.
Excuse me. Okay. Dumbo, what's this board may look like for you?
Like Bob was saying, some good civil arguments. You know, as long as they're civil, there tends to be this atmosphere where if you argue about something, that how dare you, how bad it is, it makes us all look bad. And I think the idea really is that, you know, good civil discourse is good. Let's have that conversation, let's have the back and forth, let's talk, let's be respectful. And respect's a word that I keep hearing all around this table from everybody, and I think that really gets to the root of one of our big problems. I think many of us have lost respect for each other, and, you know, I can just tell you some of my experiences that I believe I have good reason to have lost some respect for people. How do we gain that back? It gets back to trust, right? And I kind of look back at relationships, you know, and, you know, when somebody has been betrayed or they have been, they have broken trust, it's not something you just fix and say get over, you know. It's like a hurt kid out there, you know, and they got to, you know, get back and figure out how they're going to, you know, trust that individual again. That having the conversations, you know, amongst each other with, having the good, you know, civil arguments that we're going to have. But we have to respect staff, and I think, you know, that's key, but we also have to respect our community. And that's one of the key things. And I think, like, when Mary talks about asking questions, as well as when I ask questions, I'm asking because I'm an elected representative to the school district by the community. I'm going to ask those questions. I hear the word grandstanding a lot here, and I think people tend to mesh that in with just people that want to speak and ask and find out what the information is. I don't think anybody, you know, I don't have any agenda. I don't enjoy, you know, having these arguments. You know, I got a family. I got a full, you know, plate on my hands. But I think that we have to ask these questions because we've all taken this responsibility. We took an oath of office. And
sure.
And going back to even what Keith said, despite, you know, there's been some great achievements, you know, and some of the highlights, I said, you know, the fund balance is, you know, the highest it's been in years, you know, the highest per pupil increase we've seen in a decade, two programs in our school district, one of which just sent a kid to Harvard, you know, and Stanford, full rides. But I think that also goes to show that, you know, sometimes we forget to respect and give respect to board members as well, because that's not just, you know, saying that Keith did that. You know, there was a lot of people around this table that pushed for the Advanced Academy, myself and Bob. I was in Lansing several times pushing for the pre-pupil funding increase, worked with the collaborative committee. So I think sometimes we give credit, not to ourselves, but to everybody else. And I think that as a board, we should not, you know, we should really realize that, you know, we are doing some good things. And even though we can't sometimes get along at board meetings and dysfunction, yeah, but, you know, we're getting results.
What's it look like, Joan?
Like the opposite of my first miserable summary. I would like to see all members
more thoroughly understand their role. Eyes in, hands off. That's to me board 101. A healthy respect for the board, for its role, a healthy respect for the superintendent, and honestly, a healthy respect for our board president, who has an exceptionally difficult job to do, and he has not been respected in that at all, despite his very calm and best efforts. Healthy discussion, great thing. Questions are a great thing. We have an information item first and an action item second for a reason, so that we can do all of those things. But then when the vote didn't go your way, you have to move on. And you have to see it as a board vote and not something that was against you personally. You need to let go of the places where you didn't necessarily get the things that you wanted, and keep working to compromise in places where you can affect change.
That's a good sign. Okay. The air conditioner just tried to go on.
All right, that's right.
Hey!
Do you want that unplugged?
That means...
Or is it okay?
And just the last thing is to have personal reflection. To have personal reflection and personal accountability. I hear it often. Board members, we're not necessarily touting the things that we do, and some board members do tout the things that they do. Some board members poke at other board members, and they're doing the exact same thing in return. And I think we have to all be accountable for our own behavior, and we have to do personal reflection on what that looks like and how we can be better.
Took the words right out of my mouth. I was going to say, I think we need to come into it with the group as a whole in mind versus our own personal agendas in mind. And what are we trying to accomplish that night? What is our agenda? What are we trying to be productive about, and instead of what do I personally want to see happen? I think the self-reflection, I've got self-reflection on here, is huge. I don't think that we all self-reflect. I think we pick out who we think is doing it wrong, or...
Who's the problem?
Who's the problem? Well, it's not me. I mean, I think we all need to do some self-reflection. I can tell you for a fact, there have been things stated around this table already tonight that are not factual and do not include self-reflection. And I'm not going to call anybody out, and I'm not going to name examples, but the self-reflection needs to happen for every single person around this table, and I don't think we do it.
So that's a nice segue into where I want to go next. So this is like the accident. You know, we all came to it, and we see it in a different way. We describe it differently. Describe it through our own lenses and our own perspectives. Each one of you has shared a non-favorable view of how you interact as a board, and I would be willing to bet that most of you think that it's somebody else who is at fault in the fact that the board's not working well. It's not you so much as it's other people. And so whenever we take that point of view, that it's really other people and not us, then it's hard to get anywhere. Hard to move from the place that you find yourself, because whereas now you find yourself a bit broken personally with each other, and that has to be repaired, as you were saying, John Paul. It's a trust thing. You all mentioned trust, and it's hard to get it back when you feel you've been disrespected, when you feel you've been lied to, you've been betrayed, or whatever. So what I would say to you is, it's July 16th. And you're the board, and you're going to be the board until January 1. Now, I know there's an election coming up. People will run, or people will not run. I don't know. There might be a new board in January. But right now, for the next almost 6 months, you're responsible for leading the district in conjunction with Keith. And so you can keep doing it like this for the next 5 months, being miserable and dysfunctional and lacking trust and so on, or you can try and take some steps to make it better. Okay, and the first step usually starts with yourself. Okay? So I want you, this is going to be the toughest question that I ask you, but I want you to think about yourself in relationship to the rest of the board, or what you think the relationship is, I want you to think about, is there one thing you could do? Just one thing you could do differently that might make a difference in terms of how the board moves forward? Not what other people can do. Because you have all, like, you have a long list of what everybody else should do. But what is one thing you think you could do that might make the situation better? Think about it a minute. Jot it down if you want. And then I'm going to ask you to tell me. Got it? No? I'll wait. Who would like to be the craziest person to start?
Tolerant. That's more tolerant. Loving. Louis Armstrong, like.
You could be more tolerant. He must be your guy.
No, it's just an egg in my head. Can't get rid of it. It's peaceful.
So you would be more tolerant?
Tolerant.
What would that look like for you to be more tolerant?
I don't know. It's never happened.
Okay, we'll put a pin in that.
Thanks. My wife reminds me all the time.
Well, see, there's the other thing that you guys need a little bit more humor. All right.
God's got enough humor for all of us.
He does, for sure. Heather, what's one thing you think you could do?
I think that I could reach out more to talk to individuals if I'm frustrated or have a concern about some of the things that maybe they're bringing up and have a discussion and maybe just try to reach out and really make a little bit more connection. I have to admit, I used to be like that and I've kind of almost given up the desire to do that because I've been so angry and so frustrated. So okay. I think I could reach out more.
Bob, what about you? What can you do?
I think it goes back to my, is try to trust people more on this board. You know, don't go into maybe a meeting or a conversation thinking that there is something going on. I think part of the way to do that is kind of what Rob said, is there's a lot that goes into that. Be more tolerant or more communication, reach out to more people. I know John had made a comment to me last meeting. He's called me several times. I haven't returned his call. There's a lot of animosity, you know, and maybe that's what I need to do is try to get over that hump a little bit and you know, open up the olive branch and return that phone call. Or, you know, I think there's a lot that goes in, but again, it comes back to that trust issue.
Mary, what about you? What do you think you could do?
I had the same thought as Heather. You know, John and I met a while, that was a long time ago. Maybe, pardon me?
Twice.
Right, yeah. But it was a long time ago. It was like last. Anyway, so I'm just thinking that there could be one-to-one conversations for understanding.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Joan?
I promise I wish I had written mine down, but that was exactly it. That I have really shut down and sort of given up, and I need to work to do more communication again and have those conversations. As uncomfortable as they might be for everybody.
But you know what? It's always uncomfortable.
Yep, it is.
To have conversations. They're called having a difficult conversation. John?
I don't know. I work really hard on trying to do one-on-one. And it's either I communicate with everybody or nobody, and that's from the role I sit in here, it's very difficult to do. I keep going back to an agenda. Like, I'm willing to look at, like, change our agenda or bad things too bad. I don't know how as board president to do that right now, because I got so many different opinions on how to do it. And deal with, you know, the operational things that come from Keith saying, I need this on the agenda faster than you normally do. I don't know how to go back to, I don't know how to reach out. People say reach out. I don't know how to do any more than I'm doing. I don't know.
Okay. So. But do you think reaching out would be a good thing? You just don't have
it's to a great thing, but, right. Okay. Right, somebody wants us, let's have a dialogue. Let me totally understand where you're going. And then, at least from my point of view, I'll give a suggestion like, okay, here's what I think needs to happen.
Okay.
Talk to more board members, or give me more information or whatever. So,
John, what can you do?
It kind of goes a little bit related to what John's talking about. Forgive, if I could forgive, I think that would be a very helpful thing. I think before probably February this year, I was pretty open. I felt like everybody on this board I was friends with, had respect for everybody, because I truly believe that they're good people. Things have happened, and it makes it very difficult for me to trust and even to forgive. And even what John says, you know, I'd love to have one-on-ones and conversations, but when that trust isn't there, it's difficult. At the end of the day, you got to protect yourself, you know, as far as in the community, you know. And, you know, I'm a representative of this board, and I need to make sure that I'm being very careful. And, you know, there's good reason for that.
So you're saying that what you could do is be to try and move forward and
to forgive in an ideal world.
Okay. Well, we're working with ideals here.
I was thinking kind of similar maybe to what Bob was saying. I think that there's, as different people say things, I automatically expect it to be negative. And so even if it isn't negative, I'm going to interpret it as negative. And so I think, you know, Bob was kind of describing to trust that maybe it isn't, you know, and spend that time to listen to what's actually being said rather than immediately branding it.
In communications work, there's a concept called presuming positive intentions. And it's really where people need to start with each other in their interactions to presume that people are positively intended. And when they mess up or when they do something that you don't like, it's not necessarily that they're out to get you or whatever. It's just they have a difference of opinion or you saw things differently. One of the things that rarely happens in adult groups that aren't seeing each other on a daily basis is when something happens between people, they gather evidence to support their preconceived notions about each other, and then they begin to see everything that the other person does through that filter that they have created. So they don't presume positive intentions. They just say, oh, there she did it again, or oh, he did it again. You're waiting for them to do the thing that you think already that they're going to do. It's kind of like what you're saying. So it's hard to get out of that. You know, it's hard to get out of that when you have spent months now, I don't know how long this has been going on, but it's been going on more than a couple of weeks, that you guys have got yourself into these oppositional places where you're now just gathering evidence against each other and rolling eyes and assuming the worst in each other and not forgiving and not forgetting and having been done wrong. Every one of you around the table thinks you've been done wrong in some way or another, okay? Which isn't a good place to be. So to get to a better place takes work. It takes facilitation and conversation and communication. I'm not sure that you can get there tonight, okay? Because the wounds are kind of deep, and the other stuff you guys can fix. You know, you can do a workshop on policies. You can do a workshop on how to form an agenda. You can change your agenda. You can do a lot together. Mary, if some of your issues are transparency or how things are done, you can have a study session on all of that and talk it through and come to agreement as a group of seven. It's what Heather said, you might not be everything that you would like to see happen, but if the group agrees to it and you all are on the same page, those things are fixable. You know, I could run the board workshop for you and do all that facilitation for you. That's all fixable, but not that other stuff. The stuff about, I don't trust you, you're out to get me, you're going to betray me, and so on and so forth. So, and as Heather said, it's hard to do this on television or, you know, in a public setting. It's hard to kind of look at each other and have what I call a difficult conversation. When you have to have a difficult conversation with somebody because they've hurt your feelings or you think they've treated you poorly or something, what I found, what usually happens is when you get right down to it, it was more nothing than something. But you have to be able to get to it. And most of those conversations need to be facilitated unless you're a very skillful communicator, because you can't get out of your own stuff. You need somebody to help you dump it into the center, help you sort it out so that you can get to a better place. And everybody can get to a better place because you're all good people. If you're a bunch of creeps or anything, you know, you're just good people that have gotten on the wrong sides of each other. I don't know about Rob. It's perfect. We are some world. Okay. But you know, you guys, you're nice. You know, even when I came up here the last time and we didn't agree with each other, I liked every single one of you. You were nice, and you were a lot more fun back then, too. Okay. Even though you didn't agree. So, I think I could help you. Right? I think Marlene Davis could help you because this is my work. This is what I do. I do communication facilitation, trying to help people get on the same page. If we did a little of that work, then you could come together and do this other work that's really easier than the work, than the other work.
You're saying we need therapy?
Not exactly therapy. You just need to be able to be in a conversation. You're not going to kill each other. Where somebody's holding your best good. That's what a facilitated conversation is. The facilitator is holding your best good. Because you all have your best good, but you're not all seeing it in each other right now. You're not seeing your best good. You're seeing what you want to see, which isn't good.
The worst, worst.
Yeah, you're seeing the kind of the worst in each other, some of you. So somebody has to be there to help you hold your best good. Talk through, you know, all you can ever do in that conversation is say how you feel. When this happened, I felt this way. Not you made me feel this way.
I'm going to talk about feelings, Rob.
When this happened,
you
know, when this happened, this is how I responded to it. This is how it came across to me. The other person usually says, well, that's not what I intended. I get it, but that's how I received it. So you talk it through till you get to a place where you can have a level of communication. Y'all are shut down because you're hurt and you don't want to fight with anybody anymore. Let's just ignore it. Let me just do put my head down from the meeting and hope it gets better. But it's not getting better. It's not getting better at all. And it's not a good situation. And it does bleed out into the community. They watch you all not getting along. You know, you're not inspiring trust and confidence in the community. And I'm talking about they agree or disagree with you. But when a collective board, and remember you are a collective board, each of your individual opinions only matter really when three others share. That's really the work of the board. You're not, you're individuals on this board in a collective effort. And that's what a board does. So, so I'm willing to keep hanging in here in this hot room with you, but I don't know that there's much more that we can do together unless you think so. So tell me what you think about what I just said about helping you get through these rough times. What do you think? Does it make any sense or no? And it's okay if you say, Marlene, I think you're full of crap. I don't think that worked.
I don't think we know what's next. What you're saying is next. Okay, we leave here in 10 minutes. What's next?
You guys get to decide what's next. But I'm asking you, what do you think about what I have shared with you about groups and how people get past their issues?
Well, I think we have to do something. I mean, it's gotten to a point of, like I said, it's so deep, not only on this board, but in the community. And I mean, and I think employees too. I mean, I have employees telling me, I'm so right and others are wrong, and the employees telling me I'm so wrong and others are right. It's just, it's so divided right now that we can't let it continue to go on. It's not healthy for, you know, us. It's not healthy for this district. It's not healthy for this community. And so whatever we have to do it to at least try to get things right. You know, we don't have a choice. We have to.
They are courageous conversations. People have to be willing to say the, we call them, I took a class called Crucial Conversations. They are crucial. We, each one of us have to be vested and able to articulate in a way that isn't hurtful, but is data-driven or specific to how we interpreted something. And we also have to be willing to hear what others are saying, to be receptive to what others' interpretations of our actions have been. So I think if we can all commit to that, it's very meaningful.
I also think this conversation that we've had thus far would never have happened if you had not been sitting here. I think it's critical that you have that objective person, like you indicated there, to keep the good in place, because I think honestly, I mean, based on some of the study sessions, we've had people screaming at each other and swearing at each other and carrying on, and it's because that one piece, which is you in your role, is here keeping it civil right now. I think if we were really completely, I mean, we're all being nice in the sandbox and we're all saying very professional things, but I think we have to be honest. Everybody's not really saying
right
the deep down things that we're really feeling, and the anger that we're feeling and the hurt that we're feeling, and we're not really getting down to the nitty gritty.
Right.
That's true. I mean,
so and you have to go through this process.
You're cosmetizing it
to get to that.
I was just gonna say, when I look at after a board meeting and I go home and I'm like, what the heck was that? You know, what was happening? I do think that it's a lot of it is just, I've tried to express this before, like just a fundamental difference about how a board should run. Like there, you know, there, some people think it should be a 7-0 as much as possible, and that if it's not, that's a bad thing. And so I think us, maybe that perception isn't true at all, but that's when I try to, you know, you go home after some of those meetings and you try to make sense, you know, like what, and try to say, what can I do next time so this isn't going on? And I think that's been my conclusion. And so I think if you could help us in the future facilitate, you know, discussions about, you know, policy, what does transparency look like, and have us all flush that out. Because I think we all have different ideas about what transparency looks like. What does respectful questioning of a staff person look like, you know, during a meeting? All those things, just let us talk it out. I think that'll solve a lot of the animosity too, because we just come from opposite opinions.
I agree with Mary that I think having an objective viewpoint in the process is helpful, and again, particularly because I'm generally find myself in the minority of the board as far as the 3 vote versus the 4. So I think for us, we often feel shut down or shut out, and you know, as I have in the process, I think what Heather says, we haven't gotten down to some of the real gritty things that have bothered us. I think I've made it known things that have bothered me. You know, I'll correct it. It's not board members swearing at each other. It's a board member being swore at. So, so I think there are definitely some issues that we have, and you know, we really got to get to those, and how do we rectify them? Because you know, that's really what has caused, you know, this lack of communication and mistrust. And we're not getting anywhere. We get past that.
Right. And how does that look?
So let me suggest something. When I first met you, I do something that no other consultant does who does these searches. You know, I met with each of you individually. And I wanted you to, just the reason I did is I wanted to get to know you a little bit, and I wanted to know what your issues were and what you were looking for. Because you are a collective 7, but it really did help me so much understand who you were as board members, and you were really all looking for the same thing. you didn't think you found it in another person, but you were all looking for the same thing pretty much. And so then it helps me because then I can talk to candidates and say, who said, called and said, I don't know about that water board. You know, I said, no, no, they're really fine. You know, they're really good. They're really good, okay? They're not, they're 4-3 and so on, but they're really aligned. You know, there's not a big issue there. So, but because I'm better. So what I think is, I think I should probably meet with you and just have you talk to me and tell me a little bit more in depth about what you're telling me here, and you'll probably name names and give me specifics that you don't want to do around the table. But I think that that would be the next step, that I could sit with you and then I can help you facilitate maybe a two-way conversation with somebody else that you know you have a particular issue with, and see if we can't get some resolve there. And once you've resolved some of these things that you've got going on around the table, then you can really come together and nail down the transparency issues, the policy issues, the whatever. Because those are, and you might have philosophical differences, but that's okay. That's why you bring them up. You have conversation about it. You talk about, and you know, if you philosophically believe this and six other board members believe something different, then so one person doesn't believe that, but at least you've had a full conversation. And the thing about the 7-0 vote, and I think I shared this with you before, it doesn't matter how you vote. It matters that you work in concert. I've seen boards vote 4-3 for something, and the three people spoke about why they weren't in agreement with it, that they thought it was short-sighted or whatever they thought. And they said, but the board has voted to move forward and I will support the decision, but let me tell you why I voted against it. Mm-hmm. Your job as board members is to make your thinking visible to your community so they know why you think what you think. That's all. And then you can support the decision even though you fought against it. Okay, that's what unanimity in running the district is about. Not expressing your opinion, not being a rubber stamp. But that's how boards move ahead. But they must make their thinking visible to the public, or you're not doing your job. That's Marlene's opinion. They expect you to make your thinking visible to them. That's why they voted for you. Okay. So what do you think about my idea? And I'm saying this with some trepidation.
I just wonder where it goes from there. You know, like how do we put that all together? Because I feel like I personally could have that conversation right now, right here at this table, if it wasn't on film for the whole world to see. Because I feel like it's incredibly disrespectful to the other people at the table to have those deep conversations now for all the world to listen in on and hear. I don't think it's anybody else's business but this board.
I think the problem is, though, is that this is a public meeting. You know, we are collectively as a board meeting, is a notice for it. So, I mean, the fact is that we have to comply with requirements, and not necessarily to have a video camera here, but...
That's not a requirement, though.
Well, no, it's not a requirement, but it is an open meeting to the public that they can come watch.
Absolutely, I mean, absolutely, it's a right. I just think out of respect for other people,
right.
I don't think it's necessary. And I would absolutely dive right in right now, right here, while we're all here, out of respect for every single person around this table to try and bring it together, but not for all the world who's not here, not listening, not participating, to make a judgment and start having opinions and have that flying all over the place, because that does nothing but increase the negativity and bring the district down. And I don't think that's
fair. And erode trust.
And erode trust, yeah.
I was thinking that the repair conversations, mm-hmm. the one-to-one relationship ones, would be private, would be not at a public meeting, off, like,
right.
meeting at Panera, meeting wherever, but then having the public meeting with a camera up, talking about, you know, the transparency,
well, sure.
questioning, all that.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I see it as two different things. The private ones, I want to have private, you know, if I'm talking to you, I want
yeah,
to just talk to you.
Agree.
But then when we talk about, you know, what is it, what is, you know, what is this, you know, talking about a budget, questioning a staff member about a topic on the agenda, when we talk about that, that should be, you know, here to get all seven of us together.
So, this is, the situation now with social media and everything being on Facebook and spread all over the place, creates a lot more issues. It's sort of like, I compare this to a girl fight in high school, okay? In a girl fight in high school, two girls get into a fight and it's usually about some boy. And all the girls get in it. And they all have something to say about it. And they all talk to the both the participants about why they should be in this fight and so on. When it comes down to it, when you actually get the two girls in there, they really don't have much of an issue. But it's all been whipped up by the other girls, okay? So that, I'm not saying that you don't have your own issues, but when it goes out into the community and everybody else has a piece of the drama, and I'll tell you, people like drama. People like drama. People like to create drama. And so you are the subject of drama in the community, some caused by yourselves and some not caused by you at all. So I would hope that you would want to move toward lessening the drama so that when people tuned into the board meeting, it would be about your wonderful student achievement. It would be about all the good things that you're doing in Waterford. I mean, as I said, I haven't checked in with you in 3 years, and when I found out where you were 3 years out from, you know, when I was trying to get people to apply here, you guys were almost broke, you know, blah, 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 blah. Well, now, so many good things have happened, and that is a credit to all of you. You know, it's a credit to the board for having the courage to probably make some tough decisions along the way that y'all had to make to get yourselves in the black, the courage to trust in some educational strategies that, you know, might have been new and so on. So I always commend every board for the courage to do the right thing. And what saddens me about your situation is you're really good. Like, you're good people. You just kind of lost your way a little bit. So what I would suggest, and as I say this with trepidation because, you know, I'm really never looking for work. You know, I'm always looking just to be retired. But I would be willing, you know, to do it because I care enough about your situation that I think I should probably meet with each of you, and then you will tell me who you want to have a conversation with, who you think you need to clear the air with and get to a place where you can eventually have those meetings that you're talking about, Mary. The so that would be my suggestion, and you can think it over, whatever.
I'm just trying to understand, so after those conversations take place, wouldn't it make sense that because we are one board and because we are not singular and because in many instances it isn't about one person, it's about collective dynamics, that we would have a meeting that isn't about policy and isn't one of those definitely much easier meetings and conversations to have, but rather come back together about board governance and board dynamics?
Oh, sure. I mean, that can be a step along the way, but I wouldn't suggest we come to that until you've been able to repair some of your relationships with each other, so that you're willing then to come together and do the board, that you trust enough. And remember, trust is difficult, and that's about presuming positive intentions, because when somebody is behave badly toward us, and we don't trust them, we're always waiting for them to hurt us again. We're very on the edge. You know? So that's where the presuming positive intention comes in. So part of the repairing conversation is about when you have issues with each other, you need some, not code words, but you need some, drawing a blank, you need some strategies for when you think, like when you suspect somebody's doing something to you, you call them up and say, hey, you said this is what I thought, let's clean it up right now. Okay. Mm-hmm. You need to be able to establish those relationships with each other because you're still tentative. You're still not necessarily trusting. So
I personally, and I can't speak for anybody else, but my frustration is not for what's happened to me, but what happens to our district and our board meetings. Mm-hmm. I mean, it isn't a, I know John Paul has a specific issue, that makes sense in that instance. I have a different sense that it's for me what has happened to our district as a result of collective dynamics.
I understand.
Okay.
I understand. You're all in different places here,
right?
With that, some of you feel more betrayed and...
I think it kind of goes to that, I think we all do agree that it's how our district looks, but I think we have a different, maybe that comes out in conversation and a little bit more trust, but how we see what is good and what is not good. You know, like I've always said, like, you know, when these kids are there and they see board members having a, you know, an argument, you know, as long as it's respectful, they're gonna have to do that one day. You know, they're gonna go out and they're gonna have to, you know, challenge their boss. They're gonna go out and have to challenge a coworker. And you know, I think that we do them a disjustice by not showing them that adults can have difficult conversations, and that you can be assertive and not be passive. And I think that, you know, and I think there's varying degrees of that. And definitely we've seen it go way beyond what it should in some of our meetings. But so I think we kind of come to an agreement as we work together as to what that is. You know, we talked earlier about an ideal meeting being, let's have, you know, some good civil, you know, arguments going on. And because people are transparent, they see what our opinions are.
Oh, hey. Hey.
But they see what our opinions are. And you know, that's part of the, what it is. And I think sometimes there's, you know, board members who feel that when we state our opinion, you know, or why, not even our opinion, why we voted a specific way, it's seen as grandstanding. We're necessarily just trying to inform the community. This is why we did what we did. You know, this is why I'm not going to vote for it. And yeah, and for me, like I said, it's not just one issue, it's a few issues, you know, that I had, you know, and you know, one being the superintendent evaluation and the expedited process of it. Mistrust that I have being shut out of the process. So I think that those are the conversations we need to have with the moments.
So that's what
No idea is a bad idea. So if we don't try it, we don't know how it's going to work. If we do try it, it doesn't work, at least we try it. And we move on to plan B.
But there's a cost involved, is it something we can do wrong?
Well, there's a cost involved, right.
Again, John Paul didn't make more score. I thought we got over that. It's okay. I'd say, you're good, I'm good.
I would say the superintendent thing.
But not the forget, you, we need a line example of,
you keep saying about how, when one board member, you know, swore, that was me. I thought we were over it. Shook you in the back and said, hey,
I'm over it. I respect you. I all of that respect is lost, you know, and it's.
But again, I just, if we don't have it within ourselves to be able to sit down and do that, which obviously you don't, I was over it. It's no big deal. You called me a liar. I told you to F off.
Didn't call you a liar.
This is
part of the reason too. There's no video to show to what happens when there's no cameras.
Have to get into a pissing match about that. And the camera, if we're to a place where we have to rewind a tape to say exactly what the words were, John Paul,
would you
far
or were, but they, you know, maybe it would help.
I'm over. I thought we were over. Then we shake hands. You're good with it. I said, I'm good with it. I thought it was over.
And
you're not a man of your word.
But no. See, this is where we get back to.
That's what I'm saying.
It's not a man of the word. It's the fact
you said you're good with it.
If I'm good with it, but it doesn't necessarily mean that I have that respect for you, Rob. Right? And that's,
I get
that. That's where
I get
it goes.
That, but I asked, yeah. But you keep bringing it up. I said I'm good with it. It was over.
Because it relates to the bigger issue of respect and trust for this board.
I don't see any trust in it. I got
John,
trust in
some of the practices and things that he's done. To the evaluation superintendent, he was shut out of it.
I'm serious. I mean, this is my guy.
Let it go, John Paul. It's three meetings you've talked about it in public, brought it up.
Oh, why
hasn't
he given an answer
to
the public?
He has. And at what,
point
do you. At what point
he was ready to leave and said, why don't you do an evaluation?
You know,
it was a matter of convincing him to stay, and then now all I've got is a week to get information.
But don't you think you should have shared that with the entire board? I mean, why? You say, no, why would you share that with the entire board and say, guys, Elias is ready to leave, let's figure this out.
Because you guys all know, you took the three, that I call you
and occasionally John Paul will call me, but otherwise it's like, I can't have a conversation with him. I can't, you guys, nobody answers me. I can't have that conversation.
Well, can you give them, I mean, I think you know why they don't want to answer your phone calls. I mean, every time you probably call them, it's going to raise up our legal fees.
How do you expect to get further communication if you don't return calls and emails?
Do you want to enlighten them? I
return all calls and emails.
Well, Mark posted it on Facebook, so I actually am aware. So it is public knowledge now.
For all to comment.
Which they don't know about.
Which there's no factual information or context.
Which I, as a board president, got stuck in the middle of.
Exactly.
Who do I please? Do I please an employee group or a board member or the community? I just like, the best guess was, why do we have attorneys? Let them try direction. And I was basically told, follow the direction. So
this is an example of something that happened. It happened and it was a situation, and John Campbell was in the police office for us, trying to reach out to him. But there's no opportunity for him to talk about the situation. So it was like, let's blame John. And I'm not taking that to court. Let's blame John. He screwed up. He's trying to look behind our back and so on. Maybe that wasn't the case. Maybe he wasn't. Your house. I don't know. I'm just saying that what happens then is because you guys are where you are, you ascribe the worst possible intentions to each other. Okay. So Mary, they're ascribing to you that you just want to be remains. You know, you just want to bring up stuff over and over and over again. And that's not your intention. You have other intentions. But you're all in that spot now where you look at each other and assume the worst of each other. And that's why you're You can disagree, you can have different points of view, you can disagree about policies or budgets, you can disagree about all kinds of things. That's perfectly acceptable. Is that whole thing about
I think our issue is it's not. I think we have a culture right now, it's not. Okay,
well, let's surface
that.
People get upset with you.
You mentioned the study session. Yeah. We can't have that. Anytime we ask for a study session, it's like, we're being horribly,
horrible. But since I've been president, I've never had any meeting, including this one, where I've had seven board members pick a date. So how do you do a study session?
All checked in?
Never. Never had anybody.
But on the same question, John, you have a lot of other meetings that I feel that other board members have selected the day, and you haven't brought in other board members to ask.
So
I'll bring up the budget meeting, right? That we had just barely four people at that budget meeting.
The one that you demanded, or the one that you asked for?
No, the budget meeting was the one in June. So see, there it is, demanded. No,
well,
demanded.
You know, the last one,
you
demanded.
You
don't
ask, you follow a rule, and you get support from another board member.
Three of us decided we're having a meeting.
So. Well, that's within the rules. That's within the rules. But so we have this meeting, and okay, we're sitting there. Budget doesn't pass. And John pulls out of his his hat a day that he's now going to have a special meeting, and he had this day selected. Maybe I'm making an accusation, but I'm guessing that maybe you did you check that with anybody else? You just pull that out and say,
because I had a plan B.
That's nice.
My plan B was, I'm picking a date. I'm picking a date.
You can solve that. You can solve that organizationally. It ain't that big of a thing.
Because if you look at our agenda, we are not a split vote on the majority of things.
You can decide. Thursday night, your board.
Yeah, most of our votes are 7-0. 6-1, 7-0.
You guys have to decide. Thursday night, your board meeting night. Clear your calendar every Thursday night. You won't need them all. But know that Thursday night.
No, I don't have a
Thursday. That's what we tried to do in February with the budget. We tried that. We just said that's all.
Well, but the other piece of that is you have to have something. The other is you have to have an agenda and something meaningful to discuss. What problem are we trying to solve? Otherwise, we're wasting everybody's time. And also, can I just finish? And also, if we have a study session on a specific agenda item,
we have to recognize that we are asking our administrative staff to spend time and energy. We are paying them to prepare for that. It better matter to us. It better be something that it matters to us enough for them to spend the evening with us, to put together all the PowerPoint presentation slides, to do all of that. It has to be a meaningful agenda with a meaningful outcome. Otherwise, why are we doing it? And to talk, to say every Thursday we're just going to get together and talk, you know, some of us think.
That's not what I meant. I just meant that organization, that's a strategy for something. Thursday nights of work, you have twice a month. Don't make other plans, but you probably won't. You'll get relieved those Thursdays will get relieved, but they're there for you. That's one way something is happening. That's work for you. You gotta find something that works for all of you. And that's the conversation to have. What will work for all of you and administration? What works? You know, when board members want study sessions about things, that's right. It takes a lot of staff time to get together. It's very good format. The study sessions as before, so that you know what's going on in the schools. So you understand the finances, you understand the reading program, you understand whatever it is, the advanced placement or whatever it is. That's why you have study sessions to be informed. But they take time. You can't be asked for, like, for next week. You know, a study session takes some amount of time. I think that's the staff, they have to find out that they have to work on that stuff. And remember, every time you guys make a request for something that you want, staff is then repurposed to that, right? Instead of whatever all their other work. And I'm not saying that in a critical way, it's just from an nitty-gritty standpoint. That's why superintendents get a little about, well, let's have a study session next week about something. It's not that people are they're gonna hide it from you, it's just hard to pull it off because teachers are involved, principals are involved. Mary, you've been a principal, you know when you're asked to make a board presentation, that's time you don't spend in the classroom watching stuff. So that kind of stuff. But see, you guys are looking past all that. Because you're gotcha at each other about you don't want to tell us anything, you want to hide things, you know, that's where you are right now, and in fact, probably not. So, what do you think, y'all? I know the air's gone, it's 8 o'clock.
I just wanted to touch on that meeting, and other stuff that John says, that I think our part of the problem is our understanding what meaningful is different. And when I look at it, study sessions are good and points of opportunities for board members to become educated and spend that part of that day to day. You know, I work with government as well. I understand the process of having to present to a board. I had to do it several times, but I also understand it's the fact that it's part of my job, right? Because I'm a public servant, and ultimately, those people who are on that board, they serve the public. And we have a responsibility ultimately to the community. And sometimes I think, you know, I think that, you know, people's staff and everybody that works hard, the teachers and everybody, I want to open too, we also have to remember that our community does want answers and they want information, especially a Waterford kind of community. You know, Waterford's very good college, we're in class, we oftentimes want to know what's going on, you know, we think that people are, you know, the government sometimes not be clear on things, so ultimately that's the last. I want to be able to get answers.
At the risk of how many people will be asked
for the question? Well,
presidential.
Right? Yeah,
yeah.
We see about 10,000.
Yeah,
10,000 people. So we're in November elections these days, so.
No, we had probably 35, 40,000
yeah.
people
voting. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
So it was
a third of the voters that
yeah.
voted in the presidential
yeah.
election.
All the way down to vote for
mm-hmm. Yeah, well, you
six,
figure it's 10, you got about 9,000.
Okay, so 10,000 people.
Well,
I don't know. Oh, yeah. Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, all I'm pointing out, I'm kind of telling you, you represent the community.
I understand.
And most of you represent the thinking of the community. And you interact with us, unless you're in class of service, about the school. find out all the evidence of each other. Until you get to the spot where you think you can come around the board table and do this again and with good heart say, I think we're there, I think we can do our business. I think I've settled my issues with whoever I had issues with. We're cool now. And, you know, say the things, but I'm okay with everybody on the board now. Now, you've all made that agreement, and now let's get on to the work. Whatever you want to talk about, whatever those agenda issues are, how things get on the agenda, the communication the board chair has with each of you, and so on and so forth. You should be talking about that. Do you want to meet? Do you want the, some district, some districts, the board chair meets with every board member individually once a month, lunch or something? Just to say, how's it going with you? Some know you, some don't. You guys just have to decide together what you want, how you want to operate. Because
as a board.
As a board.
Not as one person
no, no.
or two people.
No, as a board. Because each of you might be the board chair at some point. And then honestly, it's like the roles and responsibilities of the board chair should be the roles and responsibilities, period. Whether it's John or Mary or Bob or Joan or anybody. Should not change because of the personality. I mean, there's personalities, but the roles should be what you've agreed to as a board chair. It shouldn't be a surprise every time a new board chair is involved. You've all agreed. This is what you want from your board chair, kind of communication. And if that's not present at all, then get it. That's the least of your problem. So, what do you think?
I'm good. So you think when what you just watched at the heated exchange, you think you can get to pass that?
Can you fix us?
Well, it's really bad.
You can. You have the capabilities of fixing us. Okay, I have fixed you.
I know you can't. Like I
can create a situation where you might be able to have a
chance. And then you'll leave us through the process.
Yes.
If you want, we're grown ups and have to figure out our own stuff.
Yeah, we'll be grown ups and go. So,
you watched Judge TV the last few months.
I'm if that works for the rest of the people on the party, you gotta do something.
Thank you. I'm just making up as we went, because I didn't know what you were doing.
Right, it was Megan, and everyone has to respond to Megan on the year of it.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to do that, so.
I know what you are, I think.
Megan knows where to find you, though.
I can come to your shop, one time I did come to your shop.
You did, yes.
Sat one of those crappy chairs here.
Yes.
Or a flying shop, not a first one.
You're sitting in an uncomfortable chair.
I'm sorry, I'm getting gone, pointing seat or something.
Excuse me, all right, you good? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Marlene.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, John, thank you. Thanks, everybody, for